Welcome students. Today we are going to cover international performance management. It is a topic covered in cross-cultural management subject. When we talk about international performance management, generally it differs from the normal performance management which we study in HR. We talk about basic performance appraisals, we talk about ratings, but that is with respect to general national context. But when varied cultures or people from different cultures, they work in an international environment, it has an impact on the performance management, and there are several issues which have to be discussed here. Let us begin with the introduction. Firstly, what is performance appraisals? It is the process of assessing an individual's performance in a systematic way. The performance being measured against various job-related factors as well as individual traits. When we talk about measuring performance, it is various job-related factors which we consider. Say, what is the skill, knowledge or experience level of a particular person? How he has performed in the previous year? What are his individual traits, whether he is confident, he is quick in decision-making and several other traits. So these become the job-related factors which we consider while appraising the performance of an employee. In addition, one's potential for performance is measured. That is, whether he is capable of bringing about improvement in his performance for future or not. The performance appraisal outcome is linked to a number of personal decisions. So, outcome is in the form of rating, which is generally being given by the manager or immediate boss, and it is linked to several issues or personal decisions like giving bonus or not, or giving the promotion or not, or maybe the employee is capable of sending out for an international assignment or not. Now this stretches beyond appraisal. When we talk about performance management, it is some word broader than performance appraisals. Performance appraisals is what we are trying to evaluate is just the worker's performance for a specific duration of time. But when we talk about performance management, we are also incorporating the possibilities that how we can bring about improvement in the performance of the employee for future. So this stretches beyond appraisal, and the emphasis in performance management is enhanced employee performance. How it can be improved for a better work tomorrow, for bringing about better results tomorrow. So definitely it includes the development criteria of the employees. Here is a chart which represents the difference between performance appraisal and performance management more clearly. When we talk about performance appraisal, the primary focus is assessing performance and potential for performance. And in performance management, we are trying to improve the employee performance, and we are also trying to develop the employee for future career opportunities. Activities involved, we talk about performance appraisal, designing appraisal program, build database employee-wise. So here it involves, when we talk about performance appraisal, we are going to design and meticulously design the appraisal program, how we are going to rate the employees. And then accordingly we are going to create a database which would represent that how the employee's performance has changed over a period of time. But when we talk about performance management, it has set of HR activities designed and executed to assess performance and improve it also. So how we can assess the performance of an employee, evaluate it, and how we can bring about an improvement, that is performance management. Leadership, when we talk about performance appraisal, is directional and evaluative. It would be always a manager telling an employee what he has to do to bring about a better performance in the future. So it's directional. He would be in a role of North Star, showing direction to the person where he has to go. And evaluative is trying to assess and find out how he has actually performed in the last year. In case of performance management, the leadership role would be that of a facilitator and coaching. So he would be in a role of coaching the employees, you know, how to bring about more improvement, how to fill up the performance gaps. Frequency. Generally, the appraisals are done once a year, and performance management, if we talk about, is an ongoing process which would not be up to a limited time because it involves development and improvement in the performance of the employees. The degree of formality is high in performance appraisals, obviously, because it involves a lot of filling up of forms, maybe self-appraisal, maintaining a lot of database, and you know, it might take a lot of time. But when we talk about performance management, the degree of formality is low, because here we have already assessed the employee's performance, and now we are actually trying to bring about improvement in his performance, maybe through training methods or some development programs. So by now it is very much clear what is the difference between both of them. In simple, if we have to talk about the performance management process, then it's a big diagram, but we can just explain it in a simpler way. That is, objectives and strategy of the organization. First step is we have to determine what is the objective, we have to find out what strategies the organization is adopting. So accordingly, we are going to see what are the measures of effectiveness, of organizational effectiveness, whether it is productivity, profitability, turnover, or market share. Now here, we are going to determine the desired performance level, that is, what level is required, what level of performance is expected from the employees, and what is the actual performance here. Now both of them, the comparison of both of them would give you a gap, that is, what is the performance gap, and it would be analyzed at three levels, that is, individual, team, and organizational level. Determination of gap is not sufficient, but the causes have also to be analyzed, and here we are going to look for what are the reasons for this gap, whether it is the compensation system, whether it is the individual's own skills which are lacking, or it's the ethics in behavior and action. So what are the causes for this gap, and finally we are going to implement certain HR interventions, that is, certain ways of bringing about or bridging this gap. It could be in the form of giving the feedback to the employees, counseling the employees, bringing about change management, team building, talent management, that is, trying to build upon their skills and abilities, training and development, reward management, competency mapping and learning management, ethical performance training. So all these are the HR interventions which are to be implemented to reduce the gap of performance. And by this, we are going to achieve the final outcome, that is, are we focusing on quality of work or rewards or future growth, enabling environment and motivating the employees. So the outcome would be achieved, and then it would lead to an improved organizational performance. So this is overall the performance management process, which you can very well understand is a very broad process, not just involving the appraisal but also developing the employees for a longer term orientation. Now the question arises, how the performance management should be conducted for expatriates? In our previous lectures, we have discussed who is an expatriate. A person who basically leaves his home country and joins a host country for an international assignment, and generally is being guided by the parent organization. He is an expatriate and he goes out for maybe for a longer duration. Now, when we talk about the performance management here, the expatriate performance management comprises of 7 activities. The first one is linkage to organizational strategy. Now this would, you can see, these steps actually differ as compared to the normal performance management process. So here you can see that the first step is linkage to the organizational strategy. Second is setting individual performance behavior and goals. Identifying the variables which have an impact on performance. Then finally appraising the performance. Providing regular feedback on progress towards these goals. Providing opportunities for improvement and linking results with rewards. This is going to be the entire process of performance management for the expatriates. Now we can explain these steps one by one. Firstly, linkage of organization strategy and performance management. So first, it's very essential that you have to link or see what is your corporate strategy with your PMS, that's performance management system. It serves many organizational goals because, you know, strategies are, they are aimed at achieving certain goals, and so performance management would help identify employees with high potentials, facilitates reward performance equitably, and delineates an employee's need for development. This is how the role of performance management would be there, where we are trying to achieve the organizational goals with the help of certain strategies. So obviously the PMS system would depend upon the type of corporate strategy which a company adopts. Now generally, from the strategic management perspective, if we say the organization can be grouped into four categories having different strategies. So the first would be defenders, prospectors, analyzers and reactors. Now these organizations would have a different type of performance management system because it is dependent upon the type of strategy you are focusing upon. So the first is defenders, who are the low cost producers. Now here the focus is on cost cutting. So have cost control as a primary focus. Predictability and a short-term focus are value. Seek to provide good services at a low cost, maintain quality, provide customer service. HR activities are relevant in this context, that is development and training, because when the idea is of cost cutting, generally the hiring would be conducted at entry level. And so here, the more focus on HR activities would be development and training. You're trying to develop them so that they learn and they perform in the organizations. At the same time, the promotions at senior levels would be done because that would be an in-house arrangement of filling up the higher positions because you are focusing on cost cutting. So employees are expected to stay with the organization for a longer duration. So the performance management system in such organization is based on outcome result as well as on behavioral traits. Next is prospectors, that is innovators, that is those organizations who have a focus on creativity, bringing about new ideas and designing new products, or maybe redeploy the resources from the discontinued products to development of new ones, and organizational conditions that would foster risk-taking, cooperation and a long-term perspective. HR activities would involve hiring of talented individuals, and training would be mostly done on the job. Employee turnover is going to be high because, you know, we are having the talented employees here, and they would go in for change of jobs as and when they find a better opportunity. So it's obviously going to be very high. Now here the performance appraisals would be result based, that is emphasis on skills identification, whether the person possesses a specific skill or not, although the hiring has been done on that basis, but whether he has actually performed based on the skills he has or not. Acquisition of human resources from external sources. So we have focused on, you know, hiring from external sources instead of giving more emphasis of internal sources, that is within the organization, and hence more focus would be on trying to have better employees. So performance management is going to be on result basis. The third strategy is or the type of organization is analyzer, who operates in two types of product market domains, stable domain and changing domain. These firms are generally of some hybrid type, that is, they are both product innovators and competitors in long run production lines. So we can say these are a mixed form of organizations, focused on innovation as well as a part of cost cutting in long run. So the personnel policies fall between the extremes of defenders and prospectors. The firms spend heavily on training, and talents are also bought to fill higher level positions. So you would hire at the higher level positions as well. You're going to hire new employees from the external market to fill in the positions of higher level management positions. Performance management system would focus on result as well as behavioral traits. The fourth is reactors. These organizations, they operate in a highly competitive market, and generally they are slaves of the environment. So any change which takes place in the environment would have an impact on the organization, and the organization is going to adopt this type of change. There are a few systematic strategy implications. The PMS would focus on results, as well as the behavioral traits play a major role in assessing the employee's performance. This we have seen the first stage when we are trying to evaluate an expatriate, that is how we can link the PMS system with the organizational strategy. Now the second step is setting individual performance goals. Now here it's very important that you link the unit goals to individual team goals. It's very essential because that alignment of common interest should be there. So popularly, goals seek to serve several purposes. You can see them very well, and they guide and direct behavior. They offer benchmarks for employees to strive towards excellence and reflect what employees and managers consider as important. One thing to be kept in mind is that is while setting up the goals, the organizations should follow the SMART principle, that is having specific, measurable, achievable, realistic and timely goals. Goals need to be carefully identified depending on the following factors. The resources need to be provided for the individuals and teams. So finance is very important. Then to make decisions at the unit levels needs to be clearly identified. And the power of authority and control on local spending would need to be ensured for smooth operational decisions. Secondly, participation of the teams in goal setting should be there, and there is also the need for prioritizing the goals. So this is very essential. This is the second step, that is when we are talking of expatriates, the goals have to be set up very smartly and they have to be very clear and easily achieved, to be achieved. Now the third step is identifying the variables affecting performance. Specifically, when we talk about non-expatriates, the factors which influence the performance have to be determined. So these are generally job extrinsic factors, that is working conditions and company policy, and we have job intrinsic factors, that is challenging job and career prospects. But in case of an expatriate, there are several other factors which might have an influence on the performance. What are these? The first one is compensation package. Now, compensation package plays a very important role, because here money is a big motivator, and so it has to be determined accordingly. Second is tasks, headquarters support, host environment and cultural adjustment. We are going to do these in detail. Firstly, compensation package. Now it is perceived as a balancing factor for the emotional relocation that assignment demands. Now when talking of expatriate, the expatriates generally move from their home country to the host country in an expectation that they might be rewarded properly. And this might cover up for the emotional disturbance caused to them. As we have seen in the Herzberg's two-factor theory of motivation, money is a hygiene factor which, you know, acts as a which would not actually motivate an employee but would remove dissatisfaction. But still, the various other studies have shown that money still continues to remain as one of the most significant motivators for expatriates. So compensation package is a very important factor or variable which have an impact on the expatriate's performance. Second is task, that is the nature of job also influences the performance. A tougher task tends to evoke better performance than a job which is relatively easy to handle. How work is viewed by the expatriate also matters. So what type of task is being given to him, whether it is too simple, whether it is challenging or not, all these have an impact on the performance of the expatriate. The third factor is headquarters support. So, because the person is actually working in a host country and he is being sent directions by the headquarters. So, how far the headquarters has given him a support in making extra money, improving his career prospects, whether they actually believe that yes, he is trying to be loyal to the organization, because say if he is working into very unfavorable situations in an environment which is lot of tension is there, so political disturbance is there. So in such situation, you know, is headquarters understanding the fact that how loyal the person is? Commitment to make the arm successful. It is necessary that the home office extends support and offers moral courage, particularly in times when the expatriate is passing through a culture shock. Now, culture shock is actually a stage wherein, where the person has actually entered into an international environment. And initially, he enjoys being there. He enjoys all the new, favorable things, environment. And suddenly, after some time, he realizes that he finds a very difficult and uncomfortable environment. Maybe he's facing problems per se, language, or maybe different cultural adjustment. So that is a stage, what we call as culture shock stage. And here the headquarters can help him by providing certain trainings, by providing some form of assistance, from the parent company, which might help him out to recover this culture shock and come back to a normal pace of work. So these are the facilities required from the headquarters. Organization support in managing the practical problems, setting up home in a new culture, enabling an expatriate to settle down. The provision of timely psychological counseling for expatriates, that is contributing to their mental health and performance. The families of employees should also be assisted. Then another factor or variable which has an impact on the performance is host environment. Host environment is a place where the expatriate is working currently, and it might be, there might be several reasons why he has not performed or why, which has an impact on his performance. Direct impact. So hostile host country environment, maybe when the country is undergoing some political changes or laws have changed, in that situation it might have an impact on his performance. So expatriates would be under constant pressure and often there is a threat to their life itself. So the form of ownership of the subsidiary is important too. This is another factor, that is, say if it is a wholly owned subsidiary in some country. Now, wholly owned subsidiary would not have an interference from anybody else but only the parent organization. But in case of a joint venture, these two companies are actually coming together and setting up a subsidiary. So, working in two diverse cultures maybe would be a difficult task for the expatriate. So again, the form of ownership of the subsidiary is again important. So these are all the variables which have an impact on the expatriate's performance. Now, what are the variables which we have to see when we talk about cultural adjustment? So, multicultural adjustability refers to being sensitive to the host culture, and you require all these traits here: multicultural sensitivity, language ability, diplomacy, adaptability, positive attitude, emotional stability, and maturity, that is to accept things going wrong. So these are all the factors or variables which will have an impact on the performance of an expatriate. Now the next step in the performance management process for an expatriate is appraising the performance. Now while appraising the performance, there are three key areas. Firstly, specifying the performance criteria, identifying the appraisers, and deciding on the frequency of appraisal. So three things have to be seen when you are actually rating an expatriate in your country. So first is the performance criteria have to be judged. Now the criteria for assessing performance should be clear, relevant, practical, and reliable if assessments were to be meaningful. And there would be generally three performance indicators. One is trait based, that is you would actually assess the expatriate based on the traits: how open he is to other cultures, ability to live in other cultures, loyalty towards the company, articulation and level of initiative. Focus here is on what a person is and not on what he or she does. So trait based is one performance indicator wherein you are going to judge an expatriate based on the traits he possesses. Behavior based is focus on what the person actually does, how he has accomplished the job, and how job is important for him, so what he has actually done. And lastly, result based, the third indicator, is that how much profit the assignee brought into the organization during the assignment. Adherence to target dates for commissioning plants and offices, and establishing strategic alliances. So all these are the results which an expatriate has he brought in, or has he actually worked on this or not. This is how we are going to appraise the performance. The other criteria or other ways of assessment might be, there is a new approach which we call it as a balanced scorecard approach, which was propounded by Kaplan and Norton. And generally it has been linked to performance management, this scorecard. That is, in situations where you have to assess the employee's performance, there are four perspectives given by this scorecard. Financial perspective is obviously what had been followed, you know, trying to see the result of the employee, how he has contributed. The internal business perspective focuses on production and operating statistics. Order fulfillment or cost per order. These are going to be certain other criteria of evaluation. The innovation and learning perspective, that is how far the employee has a potential to learn and grow. And the customer perspective, that is taking the customer's view. What has been the impact of the expatriate's work on customer? Means maybe may not be the direct impact, but then has he actually contributed towards the customer retention and satisfaction. So this is one way of assessing an expatriate. Now the second question arises in appraising the performance is, who should be the appraisers? Now appraisers are the immediate managers or leaders at the host and parent locations, team members and clients. Self-appraisal is also very common, wherein the expatriate himself fills up a form asking certain questions, and he tries to give in how he has performed the year round. In most MNCs, appraisal system have a combination of these appraisers. So it can be team members, it can be, you know, people or managers at parent locations or clients. But there are certain other common practices which are adopted. One of them is metrics reporting. Now herein, generally, an expatriate has to, he is being evaluated actually by two of the managers. Maybe one at the host country and another at the home country, or both of them at the host country itself. So So they actually rate this this person, this employee, and the average of the ratings of the both managers is being considered to be the final rating for the employee. That is matrix reporting. There is use of 360 degree appraisal, and the third is a review cycle. So 360 degree appraisal we talk of is actually appraising the employee from all around, maybe by his peers, by immediate bosses, by subordinates, by customers, suppliers. There can be a number of parties who are going to appraise the expatriate. Now, the third thing is, what should be the frequency of assessment? How far, what should be the time duration of assessment of these employees? So, general trend is to evaluate once in 3 months, or maybe 6 months, or once in a year. There was a survey which was conducted by Arthur Anderson, wherein it said that 70% of the organizations, they conduct performance appraisals once in a year. So that would be the duration of appraisal of these expatriates. There is providing feedback. Feedback controls the work behavior of employees by directing actions, opportunities for improvement. That is, if there has been any performance gap, then how it can be filled in, and what can be the methods of filling up that gap. So whether the person is capable of improving the performance or not, everything has to be seen. So opportunities to expatriates to improve, socialize and adjust to local environment ably. And finally, linking the rewards and results. So once the performance appraisals have been done, how it can be linked with the rewards, which is again a very tough task, depending on what rewards are being valued by the expatriate. So establishing the linkage between performance and compensation is very important. Now that was the performance management for an expatriate. Now generally, what are the issues in managing performance in global context? What issues come across the career of a manager when he's actually he's appraising the employee in an international context? So the first thing is cultural consequences on performance management. Culture plays a very big role. So culture would have an impact on performance management, that is in case of rewarding, managing underperformers, managing virtual teams. Now virtual teams are actually people who are not sitting together, but they are available on the internet and they are in faraway locations and still they work together. So now this virtual team might have people from varied countries. Now looking into who has performed in what manner and how they have contributed to overall performance would have to be assessed. There are three ways in which cultural differences impact performance management. One is goal commitment and participation in organizations, feedback performance relationship, and feedback seeking behavior. This feedback seeking behavior is very important because in certain cultures, people they do not welcome the feedback from the managers and they do not take it positively, in just in case if he asks you to bring about improvement. But in certain cultures, it's been taken as very positively and very normal, in normal course of business. So that is another cultural issue why we are going in for performance management. Virtual teams. In order to manage performance effectively, virtual teams, managers, supervisors need to build a team identity process and facilitate the development of long distance relationships and trust among team members. So this trust has to be created, and the virtual teams play a, it's a big issue how to manage performance management for these teams. There is assessing the subsidiary performance. This is the third issue while we are going in for performance management in a global context, and that is assessing subsidiary, that is where it is situated. like difficulties in assessment is balancing headquarters and host unit performance. Whether you have to see that how far the host unit has contributed to the goals of headquarters. So it's very difficult to assess. Then attention to external forces, that is whether there has been change in the regulations. If the unit, the subsidiary has not performed well, what were the reasons? Then there could be external forces such as the laws, rules, regulations, government interference, political disturbance. All these can be external forces which might have acted on the subsidiary's performance, and that is why maybe it has underperformed. So again, you cannot ignore such external forces. Vagaries of the international environment, whether the policies have changed externally or whether in the parent organizations there has been change in certain rules, regulations and or strategies. So, you know, these things have to be taken into account while you are actually assessing the subsidiary's performance. Significance of time and distance, that is how far the subsidiaries are located, how closely they are interacting with the parent organization, whether they are regularly seeking guidance from them or not, or whether they are regularly getting the direction from the parent organization or not. So it has an impact on the subsidiaries' performance. So these are several issues which we have to see while we are dealing with performance management in global context. Thank you.